The following is a message from Christ Central Manchester, a church that meets in the heart of Manchester in the UK. To find out more about us, please visit www.christcentral.org.uk.
Please, if you have a Bible or an app, please turn to Amos. It'll be easier to find on an app than it is in a Bible for most, because it's hidden. Amos is always hidden amongst the last few books of the Old Testament. Last week we kicked off this series in the book of Amos. It's, as I said last week, it's a little known book, it's a little known fella in the Bible, a shepherd from the southern kingdom of Judah who ends up in the northern kingdom of Israel, because by then the kingdom that was one is split. We'll see a bit more about that as we look at this passage. But it's not one of those books, it's not one of those passages that you'd go to, and that's why partly why we've gone there. Because I think God loves to use the unknown or the obscure or the hidden away, and he loves to bring them out. And if you feel like that, if you feel a little bit overlooked or hidden in any sphere, in work, in life, in friendships, in family, if you feel like you're always the one at the end of the line and all the other brothers and sisters get it, then you're in good company, because that was David and that's Amos, and God loves to use people like that. And so here we are. Last week we looked at God's judgment upon the nations around Israel. We saw that he is a roaring lion who will bring judgment. He doesn't let sin go unpunished. We see horrific atrocities in history. We see them today. Remember, it was only last week that London, the thing in London happened on the bridge, and all the atrocities that went with that and all the horrendous loss of life. And we know that stuff happens, sometimes on our doorstep, sometimes further away, sometimes in history, sometimes in the present day. We know it happens, and we can assume or think that God doesn't see it or doesn't care. Actually, he sees all of it. Remember, we looked at these three, for three sins, we're going to hear that phrase again. For three sins and for four, I'm not going to relent, says God. And we see that again. So he will judge sin, he will judge atrocities, even though he lets it go for what seems like a long time. And we saw last week that even though we can be overlooked like Amos was, that we can be those that have a voice in a society that might be getting more and more fearful, a society that might be turning away more and more from God. We can be that voice that says, you know what, there is a God, he does see, he does care, actually he will even judge. And that actually we do want. We don't always want it, but we do want it for certain things. He will judge. And the good news is, on top of all of that, he has judged his son. And we can be the ones that bring the good news of the fact that Jesus stood in our place and took that judgment so that we can be forgiven if we accept that gift. We looked at all of that last week. Do you remember that game as a youngster? Maybe especially around Easter with that whole kind of hunting for chocolate eggs in the garden or whatever it is. I don't know if you remember any sort of hide and seek, but hidden gifts or hidden, and as a child, you remember that, those kind of games? And the whole thing where you'd say whether someone was getting cold or warm towards where the hidden thing was. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
Come, thank you. This week, the lion roars a lot closer to home. It was uncomfortable listening this week for the first hearers of what Amos brings in chapter 2. It was all like nice and cold when it was all about these other nations. It began to get a little bit warmer, as we'll see, as Amos begins to talk about the southern kingdom of Judah. And then it starts to get, you know, in that game, you're getting warmer, you're getting warmer. No, you're going cold. Warmer, warmer, warmer. Hot, 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 hot. You're there. Found it. Chocolate egg. Come on. Well, less joy. Less exciting. Hot under the collar. Hot, hot, hot promise of judgment is what we're reading. It's got closer to home. And whilst it was about all these other nations or the southern kingdom of Judah, even though they were kind of, you know, historically they were related. They were the one nation. Even though they were, in a sense, sort of cousins, as it were, it was still not about, it was not hot. It was not in their faces. And then suddenly it was, as we're going to see, it's a harsh word of judgment. It's in your face. and it would have been very unpopular, we can assume. What Amos brought to these people would have not gone down well. And we'll see that in later chapters when they try and shut him up. So let's read from Amos chapter 2 and verse 4. And the words will appear on the screen. This is what the Lord says. For three sins of Judah, this is the southern kingdom, remember? Even for four, I will not relent. So we're still warm. We're not hot yet. Because they have rejected the law of the Lord and have not kept his decrees, because they have been led astray by false gods, the gods their ancestors followed, I will send fire on Judah that will consume the fortresses of Jerusalem. This is what the Lord says. Now the heat turns up. For three sins of Israel, even for four, I will not relent. They sell the innocent for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals. They trample on the heads of the poor as on the dust of the ground and deny justice to the oppressed. Father and son use the same girl and so profane my holy name. They lie down beside every altar on garments taken in pledge. In the house of their God they drink wine taken as fines. Yet I destroyed the Amorites before them. Though they were tall as the cedars and strong as the oaks, I destroyed their fruit above and their roots below. I brought you up out of Egypt and led you for 40 years in the wilderness to give you the land of the Amorites. I also raised up prophets from among your children and Nazarites from among your youths. Is this not true, people of Israel, declares the Lord? But you made the Nazarites drink wine and commanded the prophets not to prophesy. Now then, I will crush you as a cart crushes when loaded with grain. The swift will not escape. The strong will not muster their strength, and the warrior will not save his life. The archer will not stand his ground. The fleet-footed soldier will not get away, and the horseman will not save his life. Even the bravest warriors will flee naked on that day, declares the Lord. Just a few more verses. Hear this word, people of Israel. The word the Lord has spoken against you, against the whole family I brought up out of Egypt. You only have I chosen of all the families of the earth. Therefore, I will punish you for all your sins. Do two walk together unless they have agreed to do so? Does a lion roar in a thicket when it has no prey? Does it growl in its den when it has caught nothing? Does a bird swoop down to a trap on the ground when no bait is there? Does a trap spring up from the ground if it has not caught anything? When a trumpet sounds in a city, do not the people tremble? When disaster comes to a city, has not the Lord caused it? Surely the sovereign Lord does nothing without revealing his plan to his servants, the prophets. The lion has roared, who will not fear? The sovereign Lord has spoken, who can but prophesy? Our title this morning is The Lion Approaches. I wanted to get the fiercest looking lion picture coming at you, just to bring it home. I thought I might scare a few people. So I didn't. But we're going to just do two things. We're going to compare and contrast Israel in 750 BC, which is roughly what we're looking at here, and Christ Central in 2017. And we're just going to go there and there and try and contrast, compare, hopefully see some differences. I'm sure we'll see some differences. But this week, as I said already, it's all way more uncomfortable. Israel is coming under the microscope in a way that they were not going to be appreciating. The whole thing was very, very uncomfortable. These two nations that were one and are referred to at the beginning of chapter 3 as though they were still one. He said, I brought you all, the whole family, out of Egypt. Well, that was when they were one. Under Moses, they were one country, one nation, one people. But he has already spoken about them in two different ways. So Judah he describes as those who have, and this is just to quickly list what they've done wrong, because basically he says, I've seen it all, and these are the highlights. This isn't comprehensive, this isn't the whole lot, but this is the highlights. And he says, or the lowlights. He says to Judah, or about Judah, you've rejected the law. You rejected my words and my decrees. You've oppressed the... that's Israel. You've turned to false gods. You've returned to the false gods of your ancestors. So they've kind of gone back to old ways. And to Israel, he says, you've got into trading slaves. You're oppressing the poor. You're denying justice, which is always a denial of justice to the marginalized. Or usually. So it's more of the same in terms of oppressing the poor. And sexual immorality, you've gone there. You're worshipping idols because that's where this sexual immorality would have been taking place. It was talking there about the father and the son lying with the same girl. It's talking about temple prostitution of the Canaanite religions that were, you know, in that part of the world and that they were engaging in again. They were going back to that. So the father would have been committing adultery and the son would have been committing fornication and bringing dishonor to the name of God, is what we read. They've got it so, so wrong. So wrong. And they, as we see, how? When they are the people of God. It's almost like because you were chosen, it's worse. So all the other nations around are judged. And somehow Israel thinks that they've gotten away with it because they were chosen. Actually, no, the fact that you are chosen it makes it even worse. You've got even less excuse. They've got it so wrong. And God is so clear with them that he will not let them off just because they are his people. If anything, it's worse because they are his people. I think they've got to this point where they've just got arrogant and comfortable with being chosen. But actually, they're so privileged and yet they've still blown it, is the much better way of putting it. Chapter 3 makes it clear. The prophet is speaking in partnership with God. You know, the two walking together at the beginning of chapter 3. The lion is getting ready to pounce and it's on you, not the other nations. Chapter 1 was bleak. Chapter 2 is just horrible. No one gets away with sin. I mean, if we want to just put that over the first couple of chapters, the holiness of God, the all-seeing nature of God, means no sin will go unpunished. I think sometimes as Christians we can forget that. We live in a society that wants to just sort of turn a blind eye to anything other than terrorism or child abuse. It's almost like everything else is all right. You know, but apart from murder, child abuse and terrorism, everything else is kind of, as long as you don't hurt anyone, or not too much. That's where we get to. And so we can get lulled as Christians even into thinking, oh, it's all right. You know, one day it'll all be all right. God's loving. Yeah, he is, but he's also, as we see here, holy. And he sees the lot. Not one thing will go amiss. He doesn't turn a blind eye. They thought they could carry on with religion, even if it wasn't the true religion of Israel, it was false religion. They thought that was all right. They thought they'd carry on at a different temple. They thought they could carry on with religion, the chosen people of God. But even when we see them carrying on in false religion, we see something in their hearts. And Amos calls them to account. That even when they were using perverse religious, involved in perverse religious practices, they were still, did you notice that in verse 8 about cloaks and wine? This weird thing in chapter 2, where it's almost like, it looks like a side note, but actually it's another stench in the nostrils of God. They used cloaks that had been given to them in place, that they should have been given back, but they were lying on them. They didn't care about the feelings of other people. In the midst of all this sin, we're told to think about that, or look at that. The lack of concern they had for others, the wine that should not have been theirs, it was given to the temple as a fine, or it was given, taken as a fine, it wasn't theirs to use and drink. Even in their false religiosity, they didn't care about other people. It had got so bad. The whole thing was a stench to God. And he was roaring in their faces. He was very close to home. This lion, who is scary, actually. He's good, but he's scary. He's very close to their faces now. And even if they had visited the correct altar and worshipped Yahweh, when divine compassion, as one commentator puts it, when divine compassion, so compassion from God on us, finds no reflection in human compassion, i.e. to each other, then pretend worship, wherever it might be directed, is just that. It's pretend. It's fake. It's false. It's hollow. And in verse second half of verse 4 and in verse 12, we see the foundations for all this stinking pile. Imagine it's just a big mountain of rubbish that's slowly built up over the years in Israel. And we see underneath it the foundations of this big rubbish heap are the fact that they've turned away from the law. Seems a bit silly, but no, that's the foundations. They've turned away from God, His law, His ways. Verse 12, they neither wanted the example of holy living nor the prophets that declared divine truth to them. So instead of honouring the Nazarite kind of role, they made them drink wine, which they weren't supposed to do. And they didn't listen to the prophets anymore. Friends, they arrogantly assumed that their election was enough. Their choosing by God was enough. But God almost does use that against them in verse 2 of chapter 3. And what's interesting, one commentator notes that never in the book of Amos is the title for God used God of Israel. It's like they've got no right to call him that anymore. It's like that won't be used, thank you. You've kind of blown that one. He can't really be seen as your God in the way that he used to be. The point's almost being made. You think that he's your God. You think he's like your puppet. That you can just do what you want and call upon him when you need. They were, as we'll see in future chapters, they were comfortable. They were materially comfortable, a lot of them. Obviously, not everybody was, because they were oppressing those that weren't comfortable. And the point is this. Before he is your God, he is God. Before he is the God of Israel, he is simply God of everything. And he's holy. And you will not get away with it, even though you are the people of Israel. Now, friends, how we then move that to us is interesting. We do have potential to do similar. We're on a different, very different footing, and we'll get to that in a moment. But we have the potential to do similar. We have the potential to look down on other people. We have the potential to look down upon, as they looked upon down upon other nations around them. We have the potential to look down upon people that wouldn't call themselves Christians. We can get into a kind of them and us mentality, which they did, and we're not supposed to get like, but for the grace of God, that I think is an okay Christian phrase. It is only the grace of God. It is only the grace of God. And we can assume we've got it together as they did. And slowly become arrogant, slowly look down upon other people that wouldn't call themselves or wouldn't believe the same things we do. They might even be Christians, but don't quite have the same theology as we do. Or we might even look down upon others in church who haven't quite got it together the way that we have. We might even look down upon close friends and family because we've got it more together than they do. And then what can happen, the danger with arrogance is it can lead to all kinds of other dangers. So they went from a place of arrogance and not needing, quote unquote, the words of God anymore, not needing the Bible, not needing the law of God, to creating this mountain of rubbish in the nation of sin and trampling on the marginalized, just treating people horribly. They went from arrogance into create, and it wouldn't have created it overnight. This would have slowly built sin like this in a nation like that, and sin in our lives and arrogance leading to other sin. It doesn't happen quickly. It happens slowly. It happens in our thoughts, and then it becomes in our actions, and then it takes place and becomes habits. And before you know it, there's an ugly mountain of stenching, stinking rubbish. It's like this thing just built and built, no one noticed. In their backyard, this mountain of rubbish. So they got used to the smell, they got used to the sight, they got used to the fact they couldn't see the sun anymore. It's ugly. And you know, sometimes the loveliest, seemingly loveliest Christian people can be the ugliest, most self-righteous, pharisaical, and judgmental of other people. And you know, it's bad when they're judgmental of those closest to them. God hates it. I haven't seen it often, but I've seen it sometimes in church life. And it's just horrible. It's just horrible. There's no humility. I'm right. I won't pretend to be, even pretend to think I might be wrong, because I know I'm not. But all of it starts with not prizing God. Not prizing His presence. And here it started with not prizing His word. And I want to just very quickly highlight a verse in the New Testament where Paul is talking to Timothy in 2 Timothy 4 verse 1. He says this about sermons. We never really preach on this, so I will one day. I'm going to do a little job on it now. Paul says to Timothy, and he cues it up. He says, imagine for a moment, Timothy, God the Father and God the Son are right here, right now. And one day they're going to judge everything. So he ramps up the stakes. He says, imagine you're in the presence of the Father and the Son and aware of the fact that one day you're going to be judged. What's he going to say next? Let me read it to you. 2 Timothy 4 verse 1. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, right? I mean, what's he going to say? Who will judge the living and the dead? Getting worse or more scary. And in view of his appearing in his kingdom, so his second coming, he's coming back, I give you this charge. What? Make sure you finish the race well. Live for God, go for holiness, preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season, correct, rebuke and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. Friends, the people of Israel blew it and began to build a mountain of stinking sin in their nation because they turned away from the Bible. Both publicly, the preaching of the Bible, and privately. We must never do that. Please, we must never do that. And it's both. It's not just about when one of us is up here doing our best to communicate the Bible to you. It's about us prizing it in our own lives. Sometimes we can again take on the world's view that it's just an old book with some nice stories that might be true. When actually, we read verses like that in 2 Timothy and we read other verses about it being God-breathed. This is His book. It's His book that He wrote to you and to me. And when we read it, we're reading the very words of God. And we forget that. Do you know what? I think other religions have got a better understanding of the holiness of books. I mean, you know, I don't want to get into that. But I see more respect sometimes talking to Muslim friends. And they've said things to me. I've had somebody say to me recently, Muslim friends say, you're of the holy book, aren't you? So it's not even your holy book, but you see it as something that, I don't know, Christians would even quickly go there. I'm not going to go anywhere near any more of that, but I think we have to be careful. In a day and age that loves experience, we can think that we won't experience God through this. We love worship, we love the presence of the Holy Spirit, but it can't be either or. It's both. presence of the Holy Spirit with His Word. The Spirit and the Word. The sword of the Spirit is the Word. I'm telling you how to suck eggs, I know, but I'll tell you anyway. So they failed to see the importance of the words of God. And it began to build this mountain of rubbish in their nation. It led to such a mess that would be judged. They had God's revelation and they chose to ignore it. What about us? What about us? That's a pretty negative first part of this morning. Now let's turn and see, hopefully, not only a different outcome, but a completely different foundation for us as Christ Central in Manchester and Salford in 2017. How do we differ? There's some ways in which I've already outlined we need to be careful, that we do learn the lesson. But having seen negatively, and looked at this negatively, I want to lift your eyes and I want you to see the call of God upon us, Christ Central, in 2017. And there's a couple of things to say straight away. There is no place for pride. There can't be any place for pride. And if you see it in me, if you see me beginning to get arrogant and think that I know best to the detriment of others and it's just ugly, please punch me on the nose, because I'd rather get a bloody nose than just keep walking in arrogance and blind pride and stupidity, making mistakes because I think I'm right when I'm not. Please, somebody. Honestly. Smack me one. Do it like you know, in love. Just say, I love you, I'm going to smack you on the nose. But there is no place for it. No place for pride. And when pride begins to take a root, it just leads to other stuff. Because at the end of the day, sin is always pride-based anyway. We think we know better. But that's how it started in the Garden of Eden. Pride. But also, it's worth just saying that all of this stuff, and you know this, but again, let me say it again. All of this is pre-Jesus. All of this is BC. All of this is before He's on the scene. This is all before the Holy Spirit is poured out for all of us. The Old Testament, if you like, is a record of human... It's the record of the grace of God upon a nation. But it's also, deliberately, the record of human failure, with occasional glimpses of hope, repentance, and short-lived godliness. If you want a summary of the Old Testament, it just goes in cycles. We can think, how could they have done all this? They knew God delivering them from Egypt. They knew all of these different things that He'd done for them, and yet they did this horrible stuff. They moved into this horrible realm. And in a way, we have even less excuse for when we get into sin. And I want to give an opportunity at the end. And if you know you're in some stuff that you shouldn't be, I want to just give you the opportunity to, today's the day, say, that's it. I want to stop. Because we actually have less excuse. Because we've been set up to win in a way that before Jesus we couldn't have been set up. Everything pointed, everything was a foreshadow. The sacrificial system, the kind of relentless cycle of failure and repentance was just all a foreshadow of what really needed to happen. We've been set up differently. And Isaiah was a contemporary of Amos, and he began to point to this suffering servant, prophet Isaiah, to say, there's going to be one who's going to come, and he's going to take our place. And the difference for us is we've been set, like I said, set up to win in a way that they weren't. Because Jesus came with the specific intention of dying, and we're getting close to Easter, which I'll be honest with you, I love more than Christmas. Because Christmas is all about Easter anyway. I mean, you get better presents at Christmas, but to put that to one side for a moment, Easter is what Christmas was all about. That's why He was born. This baby didn't stay the baby, Jesus. He became a man who deliberately died in your place and mine. Why? Because he got a bit overzealous and carried away? No, it was always the plan that they would use the evil of human behaviour that would send him to the cross. But it was always the Lord's will to crush him, is what Isaiah says in chapter 53. It was the Lord's will to crush him. Why? To take your place in mine. Because sin has to be judged. Because there is a holy God who sees it all. And we're very happy that he judges it when it's a killer in London. We're less happy that he judges it when it's you or me lying. But he judges all of it. He doesn't kind of go down a scale and think, oh, they're getting closer to Mother Teresa, so I won't judge them. You know, they're a bit closer to Hitler, so I'm going to judge them. You know, he killed someone, I'm going to judge him. He lied about his tax, I won't judge him. No, he'll judge all of it. And Jesus deliberately came because he will judge all of it. And because none of us have ever lived it perfectly, Jesus came, lived it perfectly, and then died in your place and mine, so that we can then have that bridge back to God that we have had lost. There was a chasm between us and God. Jesus bridged that again by dying in your place and mine. We've been set up completely differently to the people of Israel. The law that they were to follow was always going to condemn them. Did you know that? Romans 7 is very clear. It calls the law like a husband who we have now, as we become Christians and die with Jesus and are raised again with Jesus, and is specifically talking about water baptism. When we rise with Jesus, it's like we've died. Our old selves have died. And that means we're freed from this marriage we had to law. Law had its hold on us. We couldn't get away with anything. And if you take the analogy a bit further, the law was a critical husband who we could never please, but we've died to him, and now we're kind of married to Jesus, so we can live for our new husband. It's not a weird thing, it's just poetic. We've now got this friend, rather than a hard taskmaster who never let us get off, because he went to the cross in our place. The difference between the people of Israel then and us, let me talk to you about Flintstones. Bear with me. The difference between them and us, it's like they are driving a car. It looks like a car. You know, it has a steering wheel. It has four wheels. Doesn't have any windows. And it doesn't have an engine. You're supposed to use your feet. It's a Flintstones car, right? That's the position Israel were in. But compared to you and I driving, it doesn't even have to be a special car. Normal car with an engine. In the old Flintstones car, you might want to go to the shops, but it'll take you 4 days. It's longer than walking because it's heavy. It's made of stone. It has stone wheels. It's a cartoon, I know. And therefore they could go fast in it. But imagine the real Flintstones car. It's a couple of tons of stone. And all you've got is foot power. You're not going anywhere. You might just about get out of your road after 5 hours. Compare that with even a old battered, beaten up Beetle from the 1970s. It's just about running still. You've got an engine. It's a completely different scenario. We have got a completely different setup. I know it's a really poor analogy, and I was doing my best to come up with something, and it will stick in your head, guaranteed. Remember when he talked about Flintstones? What was that about again? Oh, yeah. No idea. Anyway. It's a completely different footing that we are now on. Completely different. We're set up to win because this thing will move. This thing will move. I remember when I first learned to drive, one of the things that the instructor said to me was, you really just c- coaxing it in the right direction, it will drive itself, which was brilliant. That's kind of how it is. We're set up to win now. We're new creations. This thing will drive itself. To an extent, we have our responsibility. But compared to the Flintstones car, you might as well be driving a Lamborghini. This is how different it is now. In chapter 3, verses 3 to 8, there's this beautiful, looks beautiful, but actually it's pretty scary still, where it builds up to talking about the lion. Well, do two walk together unless they have agreed to do so? There is an opportunity here for them to turn. There's an opportunity for the people of Israel here, apparently, to turn. It's like there's a trumpet sounding in the city, verse 6, and do the people not tremble? There's an opportunity. It's like the judgment's coming, the axe is falling, but there is a moment still, it seems, in this chapter for them to turn. We know, sadly, that they don't. And that God's word would be taken from them, and another would be needed, and that other is Jesus, to take our place and to set it up very differently. And then he would ascend on high, having been raised from the dead, and he would give us the Holy Spirit, and the whole thing would look very different. You and I now, I can't emphasize this enough, it couldn't be more different. You've got the Son of God who's died in your place, and his Holy Spirit with you every day, every minute. It couldn't be more awesome or more different. We dare take it for granted. They abandoned the relationship of teacher and pupil. They lost touch. They lost sight of the Bible. They lost sight of God's presence and the privilege of knowing him. Friends, we dare do that, and we are set up differently to that now. So we are now called to love God's word and his words. So that means for me, the stuff that's written in the Bible. And when people bring things to us to encourage us that they feel prophetically, which means they feel God saying it through them, we're to value all of that, we're to weigh that. We don't have to weigh this, we just have to kind of discern it and get God's help in reading it. But we weigh what each other says to each other. We honour and value God's word and words. And we are called, as we do, kind of corporately through the food bank, but also individually, with those around you, we're called to look out for the marginalised. We're called to look out for those that can't defend themselves, can't speak up for themselves. They didn't. They didn't do it. One of the outworkings of their pride and their sin was to begin to trample on the heads of others. We're not called to that. And some of you burn with that to a point where you will be the voice for the helpless. You know, in these times where there's more and more fear, more and more looking after me and myself, thank you very much, locking ourselves away in our little British castles, which is a lot of nonsense, but more and more of that going on, more and more trying to keep people out, more and more fear, there's some of you burn with a voice that says it's not meant to be like that. We're meant to look out for those who can't look after themselves. You know, these children are arriving in Europe without parents, without guardians. Unaccompanied refugee children is what they're called. They're just children. And there's no one there for them. But we just want to make sure we don't have too many. Don't get me started. But we've got to be ready as well. It's not just one thing for me to say it in a sermon. We've got to be ready. And we are. We're trying to look at how we might do something in that whole area. We've been looking. So it is stuff like that, but it's also your elderly neighbour who's just struggling to get the milk in the morning, or making an arrangement that you'll go and get it for her every morning, or whatever it might be. We're to be the people that God has intended us to be. We're to be Amos's again. There is a moment for Israel to take and to turn. They didn't, and judgment fell. And we are in a moment. Did you know that? We're in a long moment. We're in a moment right now between Jesus ascending on high and going, being seated at his Father's right hand, having died in our place, and risen again. We're in a moment from then, when the Holy Spirit came, to when Jesus returns. We're in this long, thousands of years moment, I appreciate that, but it's still a moment, a bit like Amos, where there is an opportunity for those around us to turn before it's too late. We've got a story of hope, a message to share, our hearts, just to share our hearts, not to, again, look down upon others. And, you know, in the good old days, we used to bash them over the heads with the Bible. No, no, we're not going to do that. But love them into God's family. And be open and be vocal. And know that we have a voice. But we must start. This moment that we're in must start with us prizing Him, keeping on prizing Him, keeping on prizing His words, knowing the hour we're in. And rather than being consumed with ourselves, as the Israelites were, the hour is for us. As Jesus looked upon the crowds with compassion, God, this morning, would you renew compassion in us for those around us? Even on the way in this morning, we just parked up on Jackson Crescent, you know, in Hume, and these two men and a lady just walked past, and you could tell that they were either homeless or, you know, not doing very well. God, break our hearts. That A, it's not right, and B, what can we do? Rather than, just park up and ignore them. God, keep us soft, please. Soft-hearted, hard feet, soft hearts, rather than the other way around. Jackie Puller just said that, not me. Hannah, would you come up, please? I've just asked Hannah if she'd just share a story of how she's done this stuff. She's just reached out to somebody that she knows. It isn't rocket science, it's never meant to be. But knowing the hour we're in, knowing what we've got to offer, Hannah, would you just share what you share with me?
So last weekend, I was really lucky and got to go back to London, which is home. And I was able to meet with my old school friend and go and stay with her family. I became a Christian at 18, so they've known me as a non-Christian and as a Christian. And 3 years ago, her mum got diagnosed with brain tumours. And they're not cancerous, but they've caused lots of problems. And she has been very involved and spent a lot of time with Jehovah's Witnesses. And so my friend Marley had actually spoken to me about it and said, would you mind having a conversation? So we sat down and we talked, and I got to share the gospel, got to pray for healing. We talked about forgiveness, what does it mean to be angry? Lots of questions I had absolutely no answers to. But it was an amazing privilege to be able to speak with her and to share God's love with her. She's not going to join the Jehovah's Witnesses, which for me is a really plus point. And she is really seeking. And I was really reminded on the train on the way home that actually, as I pray for healing, that we have the answer to like the worst sorrow. That, you know, even though she's massively struggling, Jesus is the answer. And healing's great, and I massively believe in praying for that. But actually, Jesus can change where she is now, even if he doesn't heal. So I'd love it if in your own personal time, if you'd love to pray for her. Hannah's friend's mum will be fine. God knows who she is. I just have a really increase of faith. And so if there's somebody that's come into your head as I've been talking that you'd love someone to stand with and pray with you in, then please come grab me at the end. I'd love to pray with you. And also, if you're like, who's this Jesus? I've got lots of questions. Again, whoever you've come with or one of the leaders here, please grab them to talk it out and have a conversation.
Brilliant. Thank you, Hannah. Thank you. Thanks very much. The band would come up, please. That'd be great. Just got a few minutes. I really wanted Hannah to share that because it's that simple. It's brave. But she didn't need a degree in how to talk to somebody about Jesus. I don't think there is one. I hope there isn't one. If you are here this morning and you, as we worship right now, the offering buckets will go around, and if you're part of the church here, it's an opportunity for us to worship God with our money. But if you're a guest here, we're not after your money at all, please just relax. We would love to hear from you on the Connect cards that are in your drinks holders, as you probably heard earlier, just to let us know about anything that you're interested in, or just for us to keep in touch with you. We won't badger you, but just for us to keep in touch with you, then please do fill that in. But as we worship, would you mind standing with me? As we worship now, the buckets will go around. More importantly, I said I'd go here. Do you, and I'm not going to embarrass you, you know who you are. Don't waste it. This opportunity today might as well be the day. That isn't a word from God, that's just the way it is. Today might as well be the day. If you know you're stuck and this mountain's getting bigger, this pile of garbage that you're building, the sin, today, let today be the day. And I'd encourage you to tell somebody that you've made today the day. But make today the day. If you want help trying to fight and get out of that, because it's one thing to decide, it's one thing to pray, it then needs living out, then grab somebody that you trust to just say, I want you to keep me accountable to this. But I'm going to walk away from that from now on. As we worship, bring it to Him. God, forgive me. I'm so sorry. And He's a loving Father that will forgive the millionth time. Okay? That's the first thing. And then the other thing is, let's go again. Let's go again. You know, the poor are not just financially poor. The poor can be very rich and spiritually bankrupt. And they're everywhere around us. And that isn't for us to judge them and look down upon them. That's to have compassion on them as Jesus did. Like a sheep without a shepherd. There is a good shepherd. So as Hannah's done this and stepped out with her friend's mum, that we would do that as well. So just bring, whichever one it is, or if it's both, just bring it to Him. Say, God, I want to be one who can step out with compassion. Help me. Let's go for it.